Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our worship service for June 18, 2023. We're at Father's Day, and we will begin our worship with the ringing of the church bell. Again, we want to welcome everyone to our worship service, and if you are listening on the telephone, unfortunately, I was having troubles with the connection this morning, and so it may sound garbled at times, or unfortunately, maybe throughout the entire service, I wasn't able to fix that, and I'll be working on that this next week to see if I can clear that up, but I apologize for those who are listening on the phone. And for those who are joining us on Facebook Live, we invite you to type in the names of all those who are worshiping with you at home into the comments. Also, you can share joys and concerns in the comments if you don't mind them being public, or you can use Facebook Messenger to send them to me, and we will include those in our prayers at the end of our service. Today, we do want to give thanks to God and ask God's blessing on all those who have been like fathers to us in the faith. This morning we are collecting our joyful noise offering. And I brought my my coins to make a joyful noise. And all our loose change will go to the discretionary fund to help people with heating expenses in the winter. The adult Sunday school class will continue their Bible study on Elijah after worship today. Next week, we will not have Sunday school because we'll be worshiping over in the park. And there's still some debate about the July 2nd date for Sunday school. Vacation Bible School starts tonight, 6 to 8 p.m. It's open to children ages 3 to 6th grade. You did not have to pre-register to attend. I do know we had at least 12 kids pre-registered, which I think is good. And then if you promise to bring some items for the cookout on the last night, then please bring them to the church, right? Well, then ignore that announcement. That's okay. Saturday, Leaf is organizing a plant swap. So bring some plants if you have some to share, or come and get some if you'd like to fill your garden. Don't let Angela know about it because she doesn't like it when I go over there and get plants and fill up the yard with more and more plants. Our next Sunday, we will not be worshiping here. We will be worshiping in the park with Trinity to celebrate our Vacation Bible School program. We do plan to stream that. It will most likely be on Trinity Lutheran Church's Facebook page. So if you are worshiping with us at home, invite you to like and follow the Trinity Lutheran Church in McAllisterville Facebook page so that you will be notified when that live stream starts. And if you are joining us in the park, then invite you to bring a lawn chair or come prepared to sit on those benches. On Thursday the 29th, we will have our monthly meeting to discuss the gospel lessons. And so if you want to be a part of that, please let me know and I can email you the Zoom link for that, or you can join us in person. On July 2nd, we'll be worshiping in the backyard of the manse, weather permitting, and we will probably start our live stream just before the service begins. And on July 9th, we will have communion. Are there any other announcements we need to make at this time? Seeing none, let us join together. Oh yeah, I forgot to mention something here. Let me back up. So the images today were provided by Carla Strasser. She is in Kauai, Hawaii. And so this is the, I'm not going to even pronounce them. This is a canyon. You can see a little waterfall there in the middle of the canyon. And the Nepali coastline. And the spouting horn. So we'll have a few more of those images, and we thank Carla for sharing those images from her vacation. And now, let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship God as we listen to our meditation music. Thank you, Cheryl. Good. The true light, which enlightens everyone, has come into the world. To all who receive him, who believe in his name, he gives the power to become children of God. Our scripture lesson for today comes from Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 through 10, verse 8. Listen now to the word of the Lord. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for the laborer deserves their food. The Lord always blesses the reading, the hearing of his holy word. Let us pray. God of compassion, you have opened the way for us and brought us to yourself. Pour your love into our hearts so that overflowing with joy, we may freely share the blessings of your realm and faithfully proclaim the good news of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And let's, here's a rainbow seen in, during a boat cruise. And let us share God's peace with one another. The peace of Christ be with you and also with you. And let's see who's worshiping with us online. Karen Slingland is with us, and Noreen is with us, and Roger and Reese, and Nat. And Tessa's with us, and Dale's with us again. Welcome again, Dale. And Barb Hutchinson. And Kathy Hutchinson, and Faye Pearson. And Debbie Gleim. Karen Slingland's with us. Yvonne and Ken. Happy birthday, Mom. Happy Father's Day, Dad. Those are some of the names that I can see. And let me just double check here. See if I can see anybody else. Yeah, okay. And of course, we want to welcome all those who are worshiping with us online. If you are in the sanctuary, you can see that this side is fuller than this side again. But I made a mistake last week. Last week I said that the sides were even, but I had miscounted on this side, and this side had one extra person. So you won last week. Congratulations. Anyway, go ahead and turn around and wish peace to those who are worshiping at home. All right, let's join together and sing hymn number 348, Faith of Our Fathers. Please stand. Seated. I invite you to turn to your prayer of confession in the bulletins and let us join together in confessing our sins to God. Let us pray. Almighty God, you love us, but we have not loved you. You call, but we have not listened. We walk away from neighbors in need, wrapped in our own concerns. We condone evil, prejudice, warfare, and greed. God of grace, help us to admit our sin, so that as you come to us in mercy, we may repent, turn to you, and receive forgiveness. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us when we were still sinners. And since by his blood he did all this for us as sinners, how much more will he do for us now that he has declared us not guilty? Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, God forgives us and calls us to live for him. Amen. Having been assured of God's grace and mercy in our lives, let us respond with an affirmation of faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. Third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's stand and sing the Gloria Patri.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. As it was in the beginning, it is now and ever shall be, world without end.
At this time, as we come before the Lord in prayer, this week we are praying for Center Presbyterian Church in Loysville and their pastor, Andrew Hostetter. We give thanks for the church's caring community, united by faith as they worship and serve God. Let us pray for the session and congregation as they seek to discern their future together. So please keep Center Presbyterian Church in your prayers this week. As we look at our birthdays, today is Mike and Kathy Schrack's anniversary. Congratulations. It's also Yvonne Fowler's birthday. Tuesday, Lane has a birthday, along with Jim Orwig. Wednesday, Ron and Glenda Dries have an anniversary. And then Saturday is big anniversary day. Lowell and Chris have an anniversary. Did you remember Chris or Lowell? It's always the guys that need to be reminded. Matt and Chris Ritzman have an anniversary, and Christian and Val Capitosto have an anniversary. Are there any other birthdays or anniversaries we want to recognize? Well, let's sing and sign Happy Birthday, God Bless You to all of our birthday people.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
As I mentioned at the beginning of the service, if you are worshiping with us, you can share joys and concerns in the comments or use Facebook Messenger to send them to us. Let's start with joys. I know there's some concerns, but let's start with some joys here. Anything we are joyful about? Yes, we got some good rain this week. The grass is starting to green up again.
We had a gift of concert tickets for Christmas, and we went to a concert on Thursday night, Kathy. Lots of songs from the 60s, and sang along to every one of them. I knew them all.
All right. got to go to a concert, a wonderful gift. Yeah.
Well,
Other joys?
We celebrated Lane's third birthday yesterday.
Okay. Right. And I think that is one thing that we are joyful for, is all the fathers that God has given us, particularly those who teach us to know and to love God. So we give thanks for fathers today. As we think about concerns for those who may not have heard about it, yesterday was a very violent day down in Mifflintown. There was an altercation between a suspect and state troopers. A state trooper was shot and rushed to the hospital. In the final confrontation, another state trooper was shot and killed, and the suspect was killed. So there's a lot of heartache in our community right now, so let's please keep everyone who was affected by the violence yesterday in our prayers, and continue to pray for the police as they struggle with that fear of facing armed confrontations. Other concerns that we want to lift to the Lord right now? What's the last name?
Pyle.
Pyle? Okay. Okay. Right. So pray for Gary Pyle, his family and friends. He has passed away. Cruiser's Cafe is having a car show today in his memory. At 3 o'clock. So please keep everyone in your prayers there. Okay. And that was Jim Portsline. So keep Jim Portsline in your prayers as he's had some surgery and are hoping to restore him to health. Okay, so Bob Swab fell, broke his leg, and had surgery and will be in rehab. Nat says thank you to everyone who has been sharing the journey that Mike and Nat have been going through with his health issues. So please continue to keep them in your prayers. Anything else? Let's bring our joys and our concerns to the Lord in prayer. Each of our petitions ends, "Hear us, O God, I invite you to respond, your mercy is great." With the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, we pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Preserving God, we pray that your people would be the voice of hope in the world. Bless us to be forthright in our love for others. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We pray your protection for all land, water, and animals that suffer exploitation. Guide us in careful use of the resources you give. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We pray your peace for those who are terrorized by threats of violence or mistreatment. Shepherd them into safety. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We pray for those who live with frailty and illness. Hear especially the prayers we lift to you in the silence of this time. Oh God, we ask especially for your healing and peace in the lives of all those affected by the violence yesterday. We also lift up our Vacation Bible School program to you and ask that through it you would bless the children and the adults in our community. Oh God, send dedicated people to show others that you care for them. Hear us, oh God, your mercy is great. As we celebrate Father's Day, we pray your love for those who are called to be fathers. Grant them joy and understanding in all they do, and extend your love to those who have no fathers. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We pray thankfully for the witnesses of the saints. May their examples of faithful living continue to bear the light of Christ for all who remember them. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy. We pray through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who also taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And at this time, I invite Virginia to come and share our psalm with us today.
This is a reading from Psalms chapter 76. Israel's God, judge of all the earth. To the leader with stringed instruments, a song of Asaph, a song. In Judah, God is known. His name is great in Israel. His abode has been established in Salem, his dwelling place in Zion. There he broke the flashing arrows, the shield, the sword, and the weapons of war, Selah. The courageous were stripped of their spoil. They sank into sleep. None of the troops was able to lift a hand. At your rebuke, O God of Jacob, both rider and horse lay stunned. But you indeed are awesome. Who can stand before you when your anger is roused? From the heavens you uttered judgment. The earth feared and was still when God rose up to establish judgment to save all the oppressed of the earth, Selah. Make vows to the Lord your God and perform them. Let all who are around him bring gifts to the one who is awesome.
Thank you, Virginia. Hello, Ellie. Good to have you here. And I think Reese is with us at home. Hi, Reese. I want to give you a present. It's not much of a present. It's a penny. There you go. Now, I'm also going to show this penny up on the big screen because it's a little easier to see up there. But today, we used a word in our gospel reading that you don't see anywhere else in the Gospel of Matthew. It's apostle. Who knows what an apostle is? Does anybody here know what an apostle is?
Follower.
Sorry?
Follower.
Okay, a follower, maybe.
Teacher.
Teacher, maybe. Actually, the definition of apostle is on the penny. Do you have an idea? Ellie, do you have an idea? Whoop, sorry. Here we go.
Let me take this for now.
There you go. So, does anybody have an idea from the penny, the definition of an apostle?
In God we trust.
Okay, an apostle definitely needs to be somebody who trusts God, but it's a different word, or a different phrase, actually. Yeah. Did you say 1 cent? Actually, it's 1 cent. Now, not spelled the same way. It's S-E-N-T instead of C-E-N-T. That is the actual definition of apostle, one who is sent, who is an emissary or or somebody who teaches on behalf of another person. Now, the neat thing about that is that the apostles aren't just the 12 that we read about in the 12 disciples that Jesus chose to follow him. An apostle, therefore, can be any of us. Any of us can be sent by God to share the good news of Jesus with other people. And so whenever you see a penny, Ellie and Reese, I hope you will remember that God can send you to be an apostle, to be somebody who will tell other people about the good news of Jesus, not just with words, but also with the way we show kindness to them. And Ellie is always showing me kindness. She has shared her bags of mints with me, and I really enjoy those. And thank you for that. All right, let's bow our heads and close our eyes, and let's all pray together. Dear Jesus, thank you for coming to save us all from sin. Help me hear your call to be sent into the world to share this good news. Amen. All right. Thank you for our time together, Ellie. And let's join together in singing hymn number 265. Sing them over again to me. Please stand. So I'd like to imagine that you are going for a job interview, and you've sat down with the employer. Yeah, those of you who are just getting retired, you don't have to imagine this. It's okay. You sit down with the employer, and you talk about the job and the responsibilities and the benefits of it. And then the employer says to you, I'll be honest with you, the hours are long. The work is dirty. The pay is pitiful. And you get no respect. Why do you think an employer would say something like that to you? Any ideas? One thought that did cross my mind is that the employer didn't really want to employ this person, was kind of hoping to drive them away so that they wouldn't have to wrestle with whether or not to offer them the job or not. But there is another reason I can think of, and that would be that the employer is trying to be honest about the work that they're doing. And I think that we can think of some jobs where that description might apply, and yet the jobs are important, aren't they? And, you know, if you were sitting there hearing this job description, your first gut instinct might be, I'm going to get away from here as far as I can. But it may be that you see the value of that work that needs to be done. And that even though what the employer told you is true, you believe it needs to be done, and maybe that God is calling you to do that work, and you go along with it anyway. We're reading the Gospel of Matthew, and we're making our way through his teachings in Galilee. And Jesus has been traveling around from town to town. He's been preaching in the synagogues. He's been healing people, even raised somebody from the dead. And the crowds are growing. And Jesus looks at them, and he has compassion on them. He sees them as like sheep without a shepherd, being harassed. And so he turns to his own followers, and he says to them, pray that God will call and send laborers into the field. And we are told right after that, Jesus chooses 12 to be his disciples, and he names them all. But note, and he also gives them power. He gives them his own powers to heal people, to cast out demons. It even says to raise the dead. And we are told he is sending them out into the cities in Galilee to proclaim the good news. The kingdom of God has come near. Now, there's something interesting that happens here in the Gospel of Matthew. We are told Jesus is sending them out for this preaching ministry, and they never go. The comparable story in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus sends them out. They actually go out on this preaching tour, and they come back, and they report on everything that happens. But in Matthew's Gospel, we are told he sends them out with these instructions, and then they never go out. Now, it might be that Matthew is simply saying that as Jesus was continuing to travel and teach and heal, the disciples were joining him, teaching and healing, perhaps even going to other towns. But unlike the Gospel of Luke, we don't have the story of them actually going out on a tour and coming back and reporting how they did. Instead, in Matthew's Gospel, Jesus goes on and on and on about how terrible the job is. As we continue to read past our scripture lesson this morning in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus says, you will go places where people aren't going to listen to you. You're going to go places where they are going to grab you, and they're going to haul you before synagogues and councils. You're going to be flogged. People are going to hate you. Because of you, brothers will hate sisters, and sisters will hate brothers, and children will hate parents, and parents will hate children. You will be dragged before kings in the Gentile world. You will be executed. Here Jesus says, you know, calls the disciples and says, I want you to go out and I want you to preach the good news. The kingdom of God is near, and I'm giving you all these awesome powers that I have. And then he goes on and on and on to tell them what a lousy job it is. why does Matthew tell us this? It's interesting to note that Jesus starts by saying, don't go to the Gentiles, don't go to the Samaritans, just stay in the Jewish lands. But then at the end, he talks about how they'll even be dragged before governors and kings of the Gentile world. It's also interesting to note that as Matthew describes defines who the 12 disciples are, he calls them apostles. It's the only place in the Gospel of Matthew that he does that. And typically, we use the term apostles to describe Jesus' disciples after his ascension into heaven. Something to note is that Luke gave us the gospel that told us about Jesus' life, but then also gave us part two, the story of the history of the church. Matthew, writing for his audience, doesn't have a part two. And what Jesus describes here about what the job is going to be like really describes what it was like for the apostles after Jesus ascended into heaven. They did go to cities around the Jewish world, but also in Samaria and also in the Gentile world. And they did proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. And they did face hostility and persecution and even death. And so it's possible that this is Matthew's way of telling his audience, this is what happened when the apostles spread the good news. It's also interesting to note where he places it in his gospel. He doesn't place it at the end, where, you know, it would be the continuation of the story. He places it here while Jesus is still in Galilee, while Jesus is still preaching the gospel and hasn't made his way to Jerusalem yet, where he dies on the cross. But at this point, there is a shift in the stories in Matthew's gospel. Before this, Jesus is going everywhere healing people. And everybody's excited and crowds are gathering around him. But after this point, we start to see the resistance. We start to see the scribes and the Pharisees and the synagogue leaders starting to resist Jesus, demanding that he explain why he's doing this, calling him, you know, a tool of the devil, sometimes driving him out of their cities, and ultimately going to Jerusalem, being arrested and dragged before the governor, and being executed for proclaiming the good news of God's love and forgiveness. And I think maybe what Matthew is saying to his audience is that, yes, God does call us to these tasks of sharing the good news. And yes, sometimes it can be a lousy job. Sometimes we will face criticism and we will be persecuted. Some people have even died for their faith. But it's nothing that Jesus didn't do himself. Jesus suffered the same things in his ministry and in his life. And because he was faithful to proclaiming that good news of God's love and forgiveness, God was able to use his life, his death, and his resurrection to heal people of their brokenness and restore people to a right relationship with God. And if we are faithful, despite how terrible the job can be at some times, then God will use us too. At the end of our service, we're going to sing Here I Am, Lord. It's a hymn that a lot of people love that draws from the words of Isaiah's call. I'm sure everyone here remembers the story of Isaiah's call, right? Isaiah has this vision of the temple, except it's not just the temple, it's the throne room of God. He can see all the way up into heaven, and the temple is just the footstool of God. And there are these seraphs who are singing praises to God, and their voices are causing the very foundations of the temple to shake as their voices thunder out God's praises. And the smoke fills the temple with the presence of God. And Isaiah is scared, you know, I am a sinner. I don't deserve to be in the presence of a holy God. And so that one of the seraphs touches his lips with a burning coal from the altar and says, your sins are forgiven. And then God's voice cries out, who will I send and who will go for us? And Isaiah says, here am I, send me. It's a wonderful story of someone receiving a call from God to go out to God's people and to share the good news of God's love and forgiveness with others. Unfortunately, the story doesn't end there. Just as in Jesus' discussion with his disciples, God then says to Isaiah, the people are not going to listen to you. They're not going to be willing to see their sinfulness and their brokenness. They're going to refuse to hear your words of prophecy. And they are going to remain stubborn and hard-hearted until Jerusalem burns to the ground and they are carried away into exile. Why would Isaiah say, here am I, send me, knowing that nobody's going to listen to him? Because Isaiah can see God's people through God's eyes. Despite their sins, despite their stubbornness, God loves them. God wants to heal them. God wants to be in relationship with them. God has compassion for them. And Isaiah sees them in the same way, and he has compassion for them, and he agrees to proclaim God's message, whether they will listen or not, in the hopes that maybe somebody's life will be transformed. That is what Jesus was asking of his disciples. Not to go out and preach the good news because they had all these awesome godlike powers and people were going to respect them and follow them and listen to them. In fact, people were going to ignore them, reject them, and persecute them. But Jesus was calling on them to open their eyes and to see the brokenness in people's lives and to have Christ's compassion for them, and to share the good news of Christ with them. And that is what Jesus asks us to do. Let us pray that God will send laborers out into the field for the harvest. Let us pray that God will open our eyes to see the people in the world with God's compassion and respond, here am I, send me. Amen. This morning we are asking God's blessing on our offerings and also on our joyful noise offering. Let us stand and sing together the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us pray. Generous God, our lives are renewed as we remember your goodness. You have made us in your image and placed in our hearts the memory of your love made flesh in Jesus Christ. That memory calls us to give and to embrace your world as we offer these gifts. May our lives, invested through these offerings, create a new reality and extend your grace in remembrance of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. And let's remain standing and let's join together in singing the insert, Here I Am, Lord.
The Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my
stars of night. I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turn away. Make their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. If you lead me, I will hold your people in my heart.
You may be seated. And for our postlude today, Max Henry will play Trust and Obey. Try that again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Max. Invite us to stand and let's close with our praise song.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done.
And one final shot from Hawaii, a sunset beach shot there. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit descend upon you all and be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.